modes of hiring are basically there are different modes of hiring in this employment laws. One mode of hiring is that direct employment, where the company recruits the employee directly on its rolls. And the other mode of hiring is that indirect employment. Indirect employment might be through vendors or might be through labor contracting firms. And the other mode of employment is that they'll be employed by the labor contracting firm or the vendor or a third party or whatever you call, is it an outsourcing or whatever it is. And even in the outsourcing, there is again different modes of employment, that the company's work being carried at the vendor's office and the company's work is carried at the company's office. The vendor employee sits at the company's work and executes the work at the office of the company. These are all different modes of employment, and each mode of employment having its own terms and conditions. But ultimately, as per the law, the principal employer is jointly and severally liable for various compliances under various labor laws, be it a ESI, be it a PF, be it the registration, be it under the Contract Labor Regulation Doubles Act, be it in respect of Payment of Wages Act. The liability ultimately rests with the principal employer in respect of the payment of wages, service conditions and other things. So as a principal employer, one has to ensure not only the compliance in respect of the employees employed by the principal employer directly, and also has to ensure the due diligence and the compliance of the labor laws, even by the vendors or in respect of the employees that are deployed to your industry or who are working for your industry at their establishment. This is very much essential. These are all the different kinds of employment. Even in direct employment also, there are n number of models of appointment, n number of different kinds of employment, even in the direct employment. Say, for example, if you take the direct employment also, there is a permanent employment, there is a trainee, employment as a trainee, employment as a probationer, and again confirmation, after probation, employment as a confirmation, and employment for a particular project or project to project basis, and employment for the fixed term contract for a specified period. He will be the employee for a specified period and automatically ceases to be the employee by the end of that period. These are all various modes of appointment, and the terms and conditions change and vary from one nature of appointment to the other nature of appointment. And before we going into these appointments and other things, basically the HR professionals today has to make note of it. There are two kinds of employees in an organization. The two kinds of employees, normally in the management terms, they call them as the white collar, blue collar. The white collar and blue collar are the management terms, not the legal terms. And the legal term is different. Legal term is workman, non-workman. The non-workmen category are those who are employed in a supervisory and managerial position, and the workmen category are those who are employed in a non-managerial and non-supervisory position. What is a supervisory and managerial position is having powers of recruitment, selection, appointment, disciplinary powers and dismissal, and as well as recommendation of leave, sanction of leave, recommendation of appraisals, performance appraisals, so on and so forth, all these. Any employee who is not discharging these functions, irrespective of the designation, irrespective of the nomenclature, and he comes and falls under the definition of workman within the meaning of Industrial Dispute Act, workman, definition of workman as per section 2S of Industrial Dispute Act, and as well as the employee under the Shop and Commercial Establishment. These are all the things, and the terms and conditions, employment conditions for the workman is different from that of the non-workman, that is supervisory and managerial. As regards the workman is concerned, the terms and conditions, it should be in consonance with the provisions of the labor laws. As regards the non-workman is concerned, it should be in consonance with law, because it doesn't mean that non-workmen are not covered totally under labor law. Because the workman definition differs from one act to the other act. The definition of workman under ID Act is different. The definition of employee under the PF is different. ESA is different. There, the PF and ESA, nature of duty is not the criteria. Salary is the criteria. The one who is drawing up to 21,000 is covered under ESA. who is drawing 15,000 up to is covered under the EPF. Employees' compensation, earlier it was a workman compensation, it used to be applicable only to the few set of employees. Now it is applicable right from the workman, class 4 employee to the general manager, the chief executive, whoever it is. So it cannot be said that for the non-workman, that is managerial and supervisory in nature, the labor laws are not applicable. A general statement cannot be made. This is the thing in nutshell about the nature of employment and kinds of employment and hiring it also, right? And next, Mr. Govind, is the difference between offer letter and appointment letter, right?
Yes, sir.
Now coming to the thing is that there is an offer letter and appointment letter in mostly earlier in the earlier days in the manufacturing sectors, they never used to use the word of offer. In good old days, I am in practice since 1987. Prior to that, for a short while, I was a HR executive. I know the HR practices and other things, and the name of the HR is also being changed from time to time. Initially, it was personal manager. Afterwards, it is an employee relation manager, industrial relation manager, and talent manager, and capability building, and the compensation benefits, so on and so forth. And ultimately, the role of the job is maintaining the balance between employer and employee and looking after the terms and conditions of the employment. One thing. And now, mostly in service sector, what I could find is that we call the offer and appointment letter, they don't distinguish the difference between these two. And offer is appointment letter is offer. That is the practice being followed in most of the IT, ITES and service sector, unlike in the manufacturing, to my knowledge, at least to the extent I experienced and I came across, both are the thing. And the thing is that what, according to me, as per law, the offer is different from that of the appointment letter. The offer is only a provisional selection, intimation of provisional selection to the candidate, and whereas the appointment letter is a confirmation, a permanent appointment, the thing is that. The offers normally are being given to the campus recruitment when you go to and select a shortlist and select some people, or initially when you call the lateralists also for negotiate for the interview, and when they are shortlisted and selected before joining, and only to seek confirmation, because the person lateral hire who we selected has to place his papers with the present employer. To place his papers, he should have some sort of written communication that he is selected over here and his compensation benefits are the salary so and so here. Then only you would be able to place papers over there. And after placing the papers and serving the notice period, he joins with the other company. So till such time. So the offer is provisional selection, wherein they say that he has been provisionally selected for the position of so-and-so, and his salary per annum would be so-and-so. And that is only to the extent. And also in most of the offer letters, I see that they will be giving offer, and their request is prospect to employee, whoever intends to join, who is shortlisted or selected to join by such and such time, and ask him to confirm. But another thing what is happening is that, of course, now due to the COVID period, there is a recession and all, not many employment opportunities. Earlier, some of the employers, my clients, they did express their difficulty that certain of the employees, they come, they take the offer, and one fine morning at the end of the notice period, they say that they are not joining. Again, for this employer to search a new talent and hire a new talent, it will take another 3 months. Because having waited for the 3 months for the candidate who got selected, or 1 month or 2 months or whatever it is. For that reason, in the offer letter, it should be unambiguous, and you should be able to protect your interest and as well as interest of the candidate. In the offer letter, it is to be mentioned that he is provisionally selected and his date of joining is such and such date. He is required to confirm convey acceptance of the offer and date of joining within such and such time after the receipt of this offer letter. In the event, if he fails to join on the due day as committed by him, he ends up in payment of liquidated damages for the inconvenience that is caused to the employer by saying in the last moment or sending simply an email, "I regret to inform you that I am not able to join." That need to be protected, right? And then coming to the appointment letter, Another coming to the appointment letter is that after the offer letter is given, after the offer letter is given and finally the employee comes to join with the organization, it can be the virtual joining, it can be the physical in person coming to the office and joining, whatever it is, that time he will be filling up all his particulars of employment application and application for employment, then the appointment letter will be given. This is the basically the difference between the, then in that offer appointment letter you will be putting all the terms and conditions, various terms and conditions. That's what between the difference between the offer and the appointment letter. Yes, Mr. Govind.
Krisha, thank you very much. And I think one other thing which always people get confused is with these some terminologies called intern, apprentice, and trainee. Would you like to throw some light that what is the difference between these three terms?
Yeah, there is an intern and apprentice and trainee. These are all the various words and the nomenclature that is used. That normally the thing is that this intern and apprentice are the people or the candidates who does internship or the apprenticeship as part of their academic curriculum. So because whether it is an engineering or a diploma or some other professional course as part of their academic syllabi, they need to have the practical training, say theoretical experience, theoretical subject knowledge, they need to have the practical exposure. Further, they say that they got to work as an intern in an industry, whether it is whatever industry it is, software, IT, ITES, or manufacturing, whatever it is, to gain the practical knowledge and to implement the subject theory what he learned in the classes. He is called as an intern. He is called as an apprentice for the gaining the practical on-the-job experience. It is as part of the academic curriculum. In that, there will not be any relationship of employer and employee. There won't be any contract of service between the employer and employee. When it comes to the training, after completing the course, academic course, be it an engineering or a diploma or some other or post-graduation or the business management, whatever it is, after completion of the training, they are appointed and allowed by the company as a trainee. Initially, they will be giving the training and later on, if there is a vacancy, they can be taken on the permanent roles, or else he ends up only taking training and quitting and joining elsewhere. And there is also different modes of training. Some companies, as part of the CSR activity, they provide training to certain of the unemployed candidates. They come work here for a period of 1 year and gain knowledge and they go, without there being any obligation on the part of the employer to give employment. And however, subject to availability of vacancy, and if the candidate, during the period of the training, if the candidate is okay and if they feel that it would be an asset to the organization, he can be observed and he can apply it fresh. There is another part of training where the employee is taken on permanent roles. Initially, company spends amount on him for imparting training, and he will be trained for a couple of years or 1 year, whatever, depending on the nature of the job and the skill and other things. And afterwards, he got to serve the company for a minimum period, because the company had invested its time, resources, and other inputs on the employee to learn the work. After learning the work, if the employee leaves, they would be put to loss. So, taking a minimum guarantee service, guarantee of a minimum service from such employees, a trainee after completion of training, companies do appoint certain training. That is the basic difference between an apprentice, intern, and the training issue. Yes, ma'am.
Great. Thank you, sir. One of the requests we have received from our audience is that
your voice is getting echo. Hello? Yes, sir.
Sorry about that. Let me just quickly ask my question. I was saying that some of our audience is saying that the speed of your speech is that would be great. And the second is that the question I wanted to ask is, what is the difference between contract of service and contract for service?
Yeah, Mr. Govind, I follow this. Perhaps some may not be able to catch. I'm going with speed as if I are doing the course of law, like a session and other thing. Okay, that's good. I try to be reduce my speed as much as possible because the old habits die hard. I try my level best. Coming to the thing, am I audible and is it clear to all the participants? Do you have any problems, Mr. Govind? Did they express any problems in the chat box?
I can hear you fine.
Pardon? Okay, thank you. I'm audible and this is okay because I always believe time and again when I say that I believe in the accomplishment of the job, not the completion, just I did the session. It is not that. Except ultimately, each one of the participants should have some sort of intake by the time the session is over. I do respect if they have any, the audience feel free to participate, feel free to express if they have any difficulties. And now, coming to the question that the difference between contract of service and contract for service, this is another question. And the contract of service is an employment contract. The contract for service is a business contract. But if the contract between an employer and employee is a contract of service, contract between an employee, employer and a third party, the company and the third party is contract for service. That is the difference between of and for. I can tell you a classic example. Mostly the HR people 100% get connected with it. With this example, the contract of service is an appointment setup or an agreement or a bond or whatever it is between employer, the company and the employee. The contract for service is a agreement or a contract between the employer and the vendor, employer and the labor contracting firm, employer or any third party company, the business contract, that is called as contract for service. That is the difference between, that is why, because initially when I started my program, I said different modes of employment, different modes of recruitment, where direct recruitment, indirect recruitment. In case of indirect recruitment, when an employer engages an employee through a third party, the third party and the contract employee will have a contract for service, and the company and the third party will have a contract for service. This is in nutshell that is the basic difference between contract for service and contract of service. I think now I'm a bit slow, participant would be able to follow it, unlike my. Yeah,
it makes sense, sir. Thank you.
Right. Yes, Mr. Govind.
Yeah, great. So, as you were talking about the different type of recruits, the one thing which came to my mind is that when we are hiring and employing people, there are different kind of modes we can hire or employ people. So, would you like to talk about a little bit of direct employment, outsourcing, and third party vendors, etc.?
Yes, and now I just already covered it, and in nutshell I will put it is direct employment is the employment where the employer directly recruits the employee for the requirement of the employer, and indirect employment is the employment employee of a vendor is an indirect employee to the company. The employee employed by the labor contracting firm and supplied to the company is an indirect employment, employee employed by the contracting firm. And again, vendor employees, I'm working, you are doing the work of the company at their premises, work of the company at the premises of the company. So there are certain precautions to be taken. Normally, the vendor, whenever, normally certain companies, they give the projects. They give the projects to the vendors and they execute the project and deliver. And while executing the project, the vendor does the job at his place, or at times he sends his employees to the company, principal employer. When he sends them, his employees, vendor employees working at the principal employer, they need to sign an agreement that they shall abide by the rules and regulations and the do's and do nots and the various secrecy, confidentiality, various aspects of the principal employer, because he is basically an employee of the vendor third party working in the premises of the principal employer, and they need to follow certain terms and conditions, certain do's and do nots at the principal employer's establishment. Normally, recently I came across a case, which is a classic example. where one of the employee, a woman employee, working at the principal employer's establishment, but really employed by the vendor, the third party, and she is working at the principal employer's establishment. The employee of the principal employer subjected her to sexual harassment. That is the first case. And now, where the woman employee got to give a complaint? Whether the woman employee got to give a complaint to the principal employer, because the person who the accused is the person, the delinquent is employed by the principal employer. Or because she happened to be the employee, does she require to give the complaint to her employer, the third, that is the third party vendor? And whether the ICC of the vendor has to inquire into it, whether the ICC of the principal employer has to inquire into such complaint. Again, that is another question. And for the ICC of the vendor to inquire into it, and whether they can prosecute or whether they can call the principal employer's employee for the inquiry or not. These are all the various questions that are involved. So for that reason, you need to specify in the terms and conditions of appointment letter that in such event, if there is any grievance of the employee of the vendor, employee of the vendor has to make a complaint to the vendor, and the vendor in turn has to forward such complaint to the principal employer, and the principal employer, basing on the complaint received from the employee of the vendor to the vendor, and a representative reference by the vendor to the principal employer, will conduct an inquiry against their employee and take appropriate disciplinary action, because the vendor doesn't have any right to take disciplinary action against the employee of the principal employer. Of course, it might be a bit confusing, and because it's a lengthy question, I don't know how many of you followed it or not. Is it clear, or shall I explain once?
I think it's clear, and I think I was looking at the chat box, and one of the interesting questions which came, and can you hear me, sir?
So may I explain again? And to put it simply, that the principal employer have right to take action against his employee. The vendor employee is the aggrieved party. The vendor employee has to make a complaint to the vendor. Vendor shall refer that complaint to the principal employer. Principal employer then take action against the employer. Right. Okay. It's clear now. Okay, that's good. Thank you. Right. Yeah. Even Rima's. Yes, it's clear. Right. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Bovin.
I have an interesting question from the audience, and I can't resist to ask that. And I think this people have asked it many a time. The question is that when a candidate do not join us, then it's fine. Like, can we do a legal case against a person who has accepted the offer but did not join?
Yeah, because the terms should be unambiguous, as I said, it should be clear. And wherein the offer letter you have to, what is not mentioned, what is not agreed, cannot be imposed. A contract is basically an offer and acceptance constitute a contract. What is not agreed cannot be imposed. So that is why in the offer letter, the employer has to specifically mention in the offer letter that he has been selected for so-and-so position and his compensation benefits are so-and-so per annum, and which shall be explained in detail at the time of appointment and other things. And he is required to confirm his date of acceptance of this offer and the date of joining within such and such a time from the date and time of receipt of this communication. If he failed to confirm, the offer so given stands automatically withdrawn without any extension. So if he doesn't confirm within time 3 days or 4 days, the offer given stands withdrawn. No need of second communication. Another communication is that if the employee confirms and doesn't join on the D-day as has been committed by the employee in writing, then the employee shall be liable for payment of liquidated damages of rupees shown, so he can fix the return. The damages so fixed are on the notional value, which cannot be calculated exactly. This is the thing. So in such event, if it is written clearly in the offer letter, once if the employee doesn't respond within 3 days, the offer stands cancelled. Suppose if he commits in writing that he would join by such and such a date, doesn't join, He is inviting the liability for payment of liquidated damages. The employer got every right to sue the person for liquidated damages. The liquidated damages, the also we have to work out the cost, compute the liquidated damages, what we got to look into it, that what is the recruitment cost we have incurred on this person. Might be paying to a third party or spending time or interviewer's time, paying TADA to such person to call for the interview, manpower spent by the superiors, and again the cost of the cost that will be incurred by the company for the replacement, because also on account of this person not joining, that replacement took place, replacement of talent took place, that cost also has to be loaded to him. That apart, again, that person would take another 3 months to join, and there is an inconvenience for the 3 months, whatever the company suffered, that could be recovered from this person. Yes, employer got every right to sue the employee, provided if there is an ambiguous term in the offer letter that the employee liable for payment of damages doesn't join. Yes, Mr. Govind.
Yeah, that's great. I have one more interesting question from appointment letter. It says that what if the employer has not issued appointment letter to the employee? Can employer in this condition terminate his employment during provision period, citing some policies and all, because the appointment letter is not issued?
Yes, it is a valid point that the terms and conditions of employment, before that we would look into it, the essential terms, because any appointment letter, the name and address of the employee should be proper. And the question, yes, Mr. Govind, what is the question you say? Sorry?
So the question is, what if the employer has not handed over or issued the appointment letter? Can employer terminate the employment of employee during provision period, citing some policies wherein the appointment letter is not given?
Yeah, here it is a valid question. Citing policies means not only the thing is that, as I told you, there will be two kinds of employees. One is the workman and the other one is the non-workman. When an employee joins, if he happens to be the employee who falls under the definition of workman, law mandates, it is an obligatory on the part of the employer to issue the appointment letter. Non-issuance of appointment letter is a violation of law. Employer is liable for prosecution. Second, that be that as it may, if the employer did not still give the appointment letter, and where there is no appointment letter, you might be covering them from the day one. ESA and PF has to be covered. If he is not covered under the ESA, if he falls under the limits of ESA below 21,000 or below 15,000 basic, then again it is a violation. Suppose in the event the employee who joined is either not covered either under either of these ESA and PF because his salary is more and other things because he is not covered, and he will be given a login facility or the employee ID number, he will be given access to the server, and the software also indicates that the employee has been engaged. It doesn't mean always only the appointment letter is the proof of employment. The acts and deeds of the employee, the service of the employee during that particular tenure he served, he might be having several proofs. When such proofs are available to him, he can always call such proofs even to the court if he goes to the court of law. So one should not be under any notion or a false notion or whatever it is, just because the appointment letter is not given, the employee is at our mercy and we can terminate at any time. And if you are having appointment letter, at least you have a chance, he can be kept on probation. And during the probation, if his performance is not up to the mark, his services can be terminated without any. After confirmation, there is a different procedure for termination. So another thing is that the service conditions of the service conditions are the policies of the company. In most of the cases, in many of the cases I see, people say that, sir, our policy is there, we can terminate the employee by giving 1 month notice or paying you off notice or without any notice. That policy doesn't have any legal sanction. The policy policy which we framed on our own. The thing is that, and if the policy should be in consonance with the provisions of law, it should be in deviation and violation of the provision of law. The provision of law and the statute supersede the policy, policy doesn't supersede the statute. That one has to keep in mind. When it comes to the non-workman category, the terms and conditions are governed purely as per the contract of service, that is employment contract. So in such event, this termination clause or policies, even for them, the employee handbook, HR manual, so many names it is used. This cannot be, we cannot expect the employees bind by it until unless you give the handbook along with the appointment letter, either a soft copy or whatever it is, by or through an intra-communication and seeking acceptance, such thing, or a HR manual. So the employee has to clearly give a consent that he has been supplied with the handbook or the HR manual, he has gone through, understood, and he unequivocally admit the terms and conditions of the HR manual or the policies. Only then it is binding upon him, or simply saying in the appointment letter that you shall be governed by the policies of the management which are in vogue at present and which may come into existence from time to time, saying blah blah blah, it is not binding on him. Okay.
Yeah, great, sir. I have another question, and this is regarding with offer letter. And I think many of us issue offer letter to people when they, when we give them an opportunity to join us as an employee. What are the critical terms and conditions we should be putting in offer letter, or anybody should put in offer letter?
No, offer letter. Do they mean the offer only before joining, or appointment letter? What do they say? Is it the appointment letter in a nutshell to say after joining what are the terms and conditions of appointment letter?
Yeah, it will be like when a person is joining the organization, what are the various terms and conditions?
Yeah, when the company, it is at the time of onboarding of employee, right? And when we give the appointment letter and other things, what would be the essential terms and conditions of the appointment letter or the offer letter, what are these things? So as far as the terms and conditions of the appointment letter is, first, name and address of the person should be clear. Name and address of the employee. Second, when it comes to the offer, you have to mention it is only provisional offer, and the final offer and selection will be only upon joining. The other thing is that position and its designation, what would be his position, what would be designation, has to be clearly mentioned in the offer or appointment letter. Third thing is that the salary, that is the package or the compensation benefits, what the employee is entitled to, that also has to be mentioned clearly in the appointment letter. There should not be any ambiguity between the employer and employee, and it should be clearly mentioned. And afterwards, the probation period has to be mentioned. How long you would be on probation, whether voice is breaking. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How long you would be, how long the employee would be on probation, and when he will be confirmed. When it probation, some people put in the letter in the probation that the employee initially be put on probation for a period of 6 months or 1 year. That is what they say that. And some of the employees, after the completion of the probationary period, they keep silent. They don't communicate to the employee whether the employee is confirmed or not confirmed, whether he continues to be on probation. Nothing is communicated. And the employer feels he continues to be on probation. The employee feels that he completed his probation. There is a miscommunication, ultimately. So the thing is that in the appointment letter, if it is mentioned, if nothing is mentioned and simply kept the employee on probation for a period of 6 months, and if it is not extended, he is deemed to have been confirmed. Suppose in the event, if it is clearly mentioned in the appointment letter that the employee should be on probation for a period of 6 months, in the event if the employee's performance during the probationary period is not satisfactory, such a probation can be extended for further period, not more than 6 months or not more than 1 year. But such extension has to take place before the expiry of the probation. It is not after the expiry of the probation, because the judgment says that when the employer is silent until completion of probation, after completion of probation, the probation cannot be extended with retrospective effect. It is nothing but ratification. to cover up the mistakes, to cover up the lapse, to cover up the gaps by the employer. So the employer has to, if at all he wants to extend the probation, the employer got to extend the probation right on time before completion of probationary period. And the extension of probation also, there should be a limit. It should not be 3 years continuous, every time before completing and your probation is extended. Because justice not only be done, it should seem to have been done. That is the basic principle that you one need to follow it. That is the thing. And during the period of probation, judgments and the law is very clear. The services of the employee can be terminated without notice. He need not follow the regular procedure of the disciplinary action, which we will be dealing in one of our sessions in detail. He need not follow the regular procedure of disciplinary action during the period of probation. After confirmation of probation, if you want to take any action against the employee for the non-performance, underperformance, or whatever it is, then you have to follow certain procedures. That is in respect of the probation. That will be the thing. And some people do put it in the probationary clause that the employee continues to be probation until unless his services are confirmed in writing and communicated. It is also forever confident. One has to be act upon before the completion of probation. Yes, Mr. Goyal.
We have some interesting questions on appointment letter, and one of them says that
and that is in respect of the probation and confirmation. Again, the thing is that there is a fixed term employment, there is a project based appointment, there is a permanent employment. In the appointment letter, you should mention whether it is a fixed term for a particular period, whether it is for the project to project basis, only for that particular project, once the project is over, automatically it ceases to be the employee. There is a regular permanent employment that has to be mentioned. Another thing is that the communication of selection and this process, and the and another thing what one has to mention is that double employment, the employee while in service with the company should not be employed elsewhere, and that is one thing. The third, another issue is that confidentiality, that needs to be looked into, that the employer should not disclose any confidential information or the business secrets or form law or process or whatever it is to the third party while in employment. And even after leaving employment, he should not disclose the secrets of the company or the confidential. Another thing is that simply saying confidential information is not enough. Every word that is used in employment contract, be that an appointment letter, be it is an agreement, be it is a contract or whatever it is, you should have the definition of words. Every day. What do you mean? Because the definition differs from person to person, but it is not deferred. There is an ambiguity scope of interpretation. When it is clearly defined what the employer means confidentiality, then there will not be any problem for interpretation. So whether it is regarding the confidentiality or the information, what is the confidential information, you should, one should define in words in the appointment letter. And thereafter, you use confidential information everywhere, and wherever it is used, such word is used, it means the word that is defined as per the terms of appointment. Another thing is that basing on, even after quitting the employment, he should not disclose the secrets. And some interception between. Somebody is intercepting, Mr. Is it going?
Yes, unmute now.
Is it clear now?
Yeah.
Another thing is that there are certain employments where the employer is employed in a position in the R&D, especially research and development or whatever it is, or even in the IT, yes, they invent certain things, and in the product development where they develop some of the products rather the services and other things. The company shall have a right, a patent right over such invention, over such product. So in that event, one need to have the clause in the appointment letter, and there shall be a separate agreement in respect of the IPR rights, intellectual property rights, that during the course of the employment of the person, if the employee is involved or is part of it, or he is the person who invented with the resources provided by the company any product, the rights or patent rights over such product shall be vested with the company, and the employer has to execute and affix his signatures and all the documents that are required for the purpose of registration of the patent or intellectual property in favor of the employer, and the employer shall not have any right over such invention. That also has to be clearly mentioned in the terms and conditions of the appointment letter, that he will not have any right. Otherwise, there is a possibility saying that because he used my resources, he used my inputs, he used my talent and other things, and other talents and team members, and then invented, you can't. Until unless it is specifically mentioned in the appointment letter that the inventions invented by such company or the team members or any of the employee, the rights over such invention rests with the company, and the employer has to execute the necessary documents for the same. That also has to be clearly mentioned. Another thing is that bifurcation of compensation. Normally, you will be saying that you will be entitled for a 6 lakhs per annum, 8 lakhs per annum, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs per annum, you would be generally the employer putting it. How that 8 lakhs is paid, how the 10 lakhs is paid, that has to be clearly mentioned. Certain times in the form of in kind, in cash, and certain tax benefits, certain tax and allowances, and it has to be unambiguous. That it should, nothing should be left ambiguous. It should be unambiguous. Those things have to be clearly mentioned. And there are certain things which cannot be paid in advance. Say, for example, when it comes to the compensation benefits, in most of the companies, they say bonus. Every month in the appointment letter, in the pay package, they say bonus. Whether they mean the bonus is a performance bonus or a statutory bonus. Statutory bonus, only certain employees are covered, not all the employees are covered, depending on the salary. If it is a performance bonus, what is the criteria? If the performance is bonus is paid monthly, whether the performance is assessed on month to month basis or it is annual and you are paying it monthly. Annual without the period of 1 year completing, how did they assess the performance? So is it a fixed amount irrespective of the performance which is bifurcated into monthly and paid? So these are all various things. Even in respect of the performance bonus also, these should be unambiguously put in appointment letter. Mostly they say that in the appointment letters or offer letters, whatever they say, the employee shall be paid or you shall be paid performance bonus up to 10 lakhs, up to 8 lakhs. What is that up to? Anything from 1 rupee to 10 lakhs can be up to. It should not be like that, depending on the performance, which cannot be assessed. So what is the system? Some policy, some scheme, some scientific scheme should be evolved and has to be put in the appointment letter for certain points. If you put it in the A grade, you will get this much performance, B grade this much, C grade this much. You have to mention clearly. Another thing is that whether the performance is paid post-performance period, not in advance, after completion of the performance. Certain things, it so happens, one has to be. So as the employee served the company during the period of performance year, and his performance is assessed at the end of the year. His performance is assessed at the end of the year. And after assessment, by the time the performance is paid, performance bonus is paid by the employee is not on the rolls of the company. When he is not on the rolls of the company, he left the company for better prospects. Whether such employee is entitled for that performance bonus or not, whether the employee got to be on the rolls as on the date of performance. So what is as on the date of payment of performance? As on the date of performance, whether he got, is he entitled for the bonus, performance bonus, only when he continues to be on the rolls? So it has to be clear. Simply saying that you are not on my rolls, I am not going to pay, because he is entitled for the performance bonus the moment he performed, completed that performance year. It cannot be avoided. Suppose in the event if the employee wants to pay, employer wants to pay only to such employees who continues to be on the rolls for the subsequent performance, the consecutive performance years at the time of payment of performance bonus, one has to be clear in the appointment letter about the objectives of performance bonus, payment of performance bonus. Pardon, Mr. Goyal.
No, it's not from our side, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, the objectives of the performance is that the performance is bonus is paid not only for the performance of the performance year, and also expecting such employee to continue to show such performance in the coming years. To encourage for the performance shown, to encourage further to show the same performance for the coming years. So one has to be clear. Then in that event, you have to split it. First, for the performance that is done, how much it is, for not continuing further with the same, because a performer who leaves, normally a setback. So what it is? So this should be unambiguous as far as the performance bonus is concerned. Simply saying that you will be paid up to bonus, and if he is denied bonus because he left employment, until unless such clause is there in the terms of appointment, it is not justifiable. And another thing is that that is about the compensation benefits. Another clause, that is place of work, where the employee is initially placed and subsequently where all he got to work. That is the transfer of employment. Even in the appointment letter, the transfer of employment should be, the transfer clause should be clear. Initially, they say that you are posted at such and such place or at our establishment situated at so and so, and your services are liable for transfer to any of our other establishments situated anywhere in India or overseas. And in one of the case laws, in the judgment, it says that when it is written like that, the employee services are transferable from one place to the other place, anywhere in India or overseas. So the employer can transfer such employee only to such places which were in existence as on the date of appointment of that employee only. Suppose if any new establishment that comes into existence post appointment of that employee, it is not binding upon. So in the terms, in the clause of the transfer clause of the appointment letter, it should be unambiguous, where it should be clear, saying that the services of the employee are transferable from one place to the other place, or one establishment to the other establishment, from one job to the other job, or whatever it is, or from one project to the other project, either in India or situated anywhere in the globe or anywhere in the overseas, and to such establishments, so not only in existence, which also may come into existence from time to time. If they fail to use this word, which may come into existence from time to time, the employee cannot be transferred to such a new place which came into existence post his employment. So the transfer clause also should be clear. And again, coming to the on-site employment. Suppose when the employee, is he continues to be on the rolls, that is the Indian company, that is L1 or process or whatever it is, and he is deployed to the America, their establishment at America or at any of the overseas establishments on-site. There will be separate terms and conditions in respect of bearing the expenditure, and he serving that, he cannot jump anyway, L1 and all, they can't jump it. If it's the H1 and all, they can jump and say goodbye to his employer and join elsewhere with some other employer and other things that possibility is there. Another thing is that when he is working there, he will be governing by the laws of the land, and if he violates any of the laws of the land, the employer is not liable for such violations or for such behavior and conduct of the employee at the place or the country where he violated, and he alone is responsible, and the company doesn't owe any responsibility and other things. Certain do's and do nots has to be mentioned in respect of the overseas employment also. And another thing is that initially it will be overseas employment, maybe for a period of 2 years or 3 years or 1 year. Certain times they will be sending them for a training to the overseas. After completion of the training, again, they got to come back and work. That is another condition. In such event, what are the documents, what are the agreements and the bonds that have to be taken and neatly be drafted before sending the person? In the event if he violates, who got to bear such expenses for violation of the bond agreement or getting trained over there and coming back and not serving? These are all various conditions that has to be looked into. It's all customized. It can't be generalized. It depends, depending on the project and the company, employer, nature of the job, nature of the work that what he got to do and other things. That is another aspect that has to be looked into. Another thing is that voluntary abandonment of service. In many of the cases, in most of the cases, they don't even ask for the leaving letter or whatever it is. They simply abscond. After absconding, they'll initially applying for leave and they say, again, I will get back to you, come back to you, and there afterwards, they don't come back. They send one fine warning, a regret mail. In such cases, what to do? So you'll have to be clear in the appointment letter that the employee, if he is absent for a consecutive or continuously without any intimation, application and sanction of leave, you would be losing lien on appointment. But you cannot do that. Even the court said that the voluntary abandonment cannot be done without giving an opportunity to the employee as per the principles of matrimony. So first you got to communicate to the employee that he is absent, and the procedure also you got to clearly mention in the appointment letter that he will be intimated first to join back, and second a chance will be given for him to come back and to join duty. Third, in the event if he doesn't respond to these two letters, then the company will presume and assume that he is no more interested in employment and lost in an appointment and he voluntarily abandoned the service and his name will be struck off from the company rolls. So you will be following certain principles of natural justice. It is not that simply employee is absenting for 1 week and directly striking off his name. That is not permissible. The procedure has to be clearly mentioned even in respect of the voluntary abandonment. And as regards the code of conduct, discipline, HR policies, which I explained to you, that in the appointment letter simply by putting a condition that the employee should be governed by the policies of the company is not enough. You got to circulate the policy, you got to circulate the HR manual, and then you got to circulate the HR manual, and he has to give his consent that he has gone through this HR manual, he understood that, and he unequivocally accept all those conditions that are laid down. Another important thing is that the policies, what all you make, should be in consonance with the provision of law. That is another thing that has to be taken care of by the employer in the appointment letters. Another thing is that where the company provides residential accommodation, there are certain other terms and conditions that has to be mentioned. Another thing is that it's communication, which is most important. What you got to say is that in the appointment letter, you got to seek his permanent address, you got to seek his local address where he is residing, partnerly residing, and also you also have to seek his personal mail ID, because the moment he joins, you would be creating and giving him an official mail ID. And once if you leave the employment, you will be freezing that official mail ID and access to the official mails, and you have to communicate to his personal mail ID. And now the e-communication through mail or WhatsApp is also widely accepted and considered even by the courts of law because of the advancement in the technology. You have to, when the employer has to clearly mention in the appointment letter that the employee is required to furnish his email ID or correspondence or phone numbers and his permanent address and local address. In the event if there is any change in any of these communication points, the employer has to inform the employer in writing with due acknowledgement. Why? Because the in writing and due acknowledgement means the employee will say, I inform you. But the employer should acknowledge it. He must have a proof of information. Then only it will be a perfect one without any ambiguity. So informed the employer. In the event if the employee fails to inform within such and such time of such change occurring, the address so furnished by the employee, be it the email, be it the local address or residential address or a postal address, shall be deemed to have been correct address of the employee, and all the communications that are sent to such address shall be deemed to have been served upon the employee whether it is served or returned unserved or bounced. So the burden of proof lies on the employee. So you have to mention in the appointment letter, in the communication clause, clearly that in the event of any change in your email, you please. If not, the same email continues to be your corresponding email, and all correspondence made to such email shall be deemed to have been served upon him and binding upon him. This is also has to be mentioned in the appointment letter. That is, the communication is also very important. And wherever the residential accommodation is provided, then now most of the companies are not doing so, which is unlikely earlier. And that is another thing is that the disciplinary action, procedure for the disciplinary action, and again termination. If the employer got to terminate the services, certain people say 1 month notice or pay in lieu of notice. Certain say 2 months notice or pay in lieu of notice. This is one of the important clauses where most of the employers do ask and approach me saying that when he got to leave, sir, I will put him 3 months notice. When I got to terminate him, I will put 1 month notice. Now, such is not permissible. It should be mutual and reciprocal. It should be the same. And one should not. Even if such a condition is put, the employer, when he wants to terminate the employee 1 month notice, when the employee wants to leave 3 months notice, such a clause is not valid. It is unjustifiable clause. Glance of it, any lay person can make out it is not justified. So it should be mutual and reciprocal and equal and reciprocal. It should not be unilateral. It should be bilateral. Such things should be there. Another thing is that certain people say that so employee served 3 months notice as per the clause, whereas I want to release him tomorrow. I don't want to pay for the other 2 months wages. No, it is not permissible. When you have imposed a condition of 3 months notice, when employee has to give the 3 months notice or pay in lieu of it. If the employee leaves without service of notice, you demand the payment. When you want the employee to pre-relieve than the due date, then you got to pay such employee and relieve. And in certain cases, even payment also, it should be clearly mentioned in the appointment letter. Clearly mentioned. Suppose in the event, if there is a 3 months notice period, if the employer for any reason wants to relieve the employee prior to the date of relieving, prior to the date of expiry of the notice period, the employer shall have an option to buy out the notice period of the 2 months by paying salary and relieve him immediately. Such clause should be there. And without such clause also, you can't buy out. That is also should be there. Anything should be in writing, it should be. Otherwise, there is a possibility because the employee may say that the 2 months you have pre-relieved me, though you have paid the wages, I am workless. Because I am workless, I became worthless. I lost the subject and the technology, I lost the subject and other things. The subject took me to the mental agony, so on and so forth. I may sue the employer. So one has to clearly mention. So the day one when the employee joins, he would be accepting it. That will be there. That is in respect to the notice period. And there will be clause also about the superannuation and when he would be retiring from the service and other things has to be mentioned. Third thing is that the arbitration clause, in the event of dispute between the employer and employee, it shall be referred to the arbitration as per the provisions of the Indian Arbitration and Conciliation Act. You can put it. That is only an optional. You can put it or you need not even put it. Because nowadays arbitration is also a 5-star litigation that you need to think. These are all the general clauses that are to be covered under the appointment letter. Yes, Mr. Gauri.
Thank you, sir. I think this is really an extensive list of things which we need to put in our appointment letter. We will make the recording of this webinar available to all the participants later so that they can review it one more time, because this is a huge list which I think they need to understand the why behind every terms and condition which we need to mention. So awesome, we have only 5 minutes now, and I would like to take some questions from the audience which are really good, and I would request if you can give a brief answers to them so that I can take as much as possible. The question number one is that is it okay that I will not join any competitor within 2 years of leaving the organization?
Yes, sir. This is also another valid question. And in most of the, because our second session will be based in the bonds and agreements, that would be our second session. and that I would be covering it. Even now I can say that any clause that is a negative covenant, a negative term and condition in the appointment letter, employer imposing restriction on the employee that after quitting his employment, employee should not join with the competitor, such is not a valid clause. Even the Delhi High Court and some other high courts categorically held such a clause is invalid and not maintainable. The negative covenant cannot be enforced. And the reason that is that because when the employer putting such condition, he is not offering any subsistence allowance for the person for the next 3 years. Having put in experience in one particular line, you can't expect him to get employment in some other line. So any person who is leading business in the same line would be definitely be a competitor, and ultimately you are depriving the right of the employee, which is a violation of Article 21 of the Constitution. Such a clause is not valid. Even assuming for a moment, saying if the employer is willing to pay for 3 years, he will be paying even off rules, and subject to the condition, he should not work with other employer. Such a clause also, it is for the employee to accept or not to accept, because if he is workless just because the sake of the money, he may be workless. When he is in continuation in service only, he will have a better prospects. When he is workless, any person would be worthless, and his work would automatically come down. So it is for them. Another thing is that in the employment contract, it should not be put that whatever we put, even if the employee signs, it is binding upon him until unless such a clause is enforceable. Because certain people say, what if they have put such clause, employee has given, you would have objected it. Just because he has given his consent, it doesn't mean that that can be enforced, which is against the law. It cannot be enforced. Even, yes, sir.
Yes, Mr. Yeah, so I think, yeah, we got it. So one of the questions which has come is that
one more thing, and even the Supreme Court in one of the cases also said so, the contract between an employee, compared the contract of service, the employment contract is a contract between which is a contract between employer and employee, is a contract between line and lamp. It is not a contract among the equals, it is a contract among the unequals. So that has to be kept in mind, right?
Thank you. There's one more question that can the notice period be for 1 year?
No, that is not. It is a new question that has put, and is rather putting the notice period for 1 year, they can as well say that he has to work a minimum period of so and so entering to an agreement. Anything can be put positively rather negatively. And another thing is that you will have to win over the person and implement the terms and conditions. Without winning over the person, just on the paper, such a condition is not a helpful condition, not helpful for the organization anymore. At the most, what the employer can do is that notice period, he can hold the employee, but not his mind. He would be physically present and mentally absent. If you compel him against his willingness and ask him to work, and the output won't be there. It's not advisable, even with a common sense, because management is nothing but a common sense. Common sense is most uncommon. So it should be logical, should not be illogical. Law is nothing but logical.
Yeah. Thank you very much. One more question is that, is there, so normally the provision period is for 3 months or 6 months. Is there a limit, maximum limit for which a provision period can be set? Can we, like, for example, can we set provision period for 2 years?
The thing is that for the IT, ITA, for the manufacturing sectors, they are covered under the Industrial Employment Standing Order. For IT, ITA, yes, certain states have made the Industrial Standing Order applicable, and certain states have not made it applicable. In the Industrial Employment Standing Orders, certain states have put it as 6 months, certain states has put it as 1 year, and it should not be beyond the period as has been envisaged under the Industrial Employment Standing Orders. Wherever the Industrial Employment Standing Orders are applicable to this IT, ITES and service. If it is not there, you can put it either for 6 months or for 1 year. It can be put it.
Sir, one more question, sir.
Yes.
Hold on. Hello. Hold on. I would request participant not to jump in. I'm so sorry for that. There is already a long list of questions which I need to clear.
Put it in the chat box. Mr. Govind would cover everything to the extent possible because we have 7 more minutes left.
One of the questions which I see, and many people are asking in a different way, and this is related to COVID-19. The question is basically that employer has offered a person, but because of COVID, asked them to not to join or asked them to extend it to a letter period of time. Can can a candidate go for a legal case against the company? This has been asked by many people in different ways.
Yeah, it's a valid question. Even in my earlier session pertaining to the payment of wages and the legal obligations during the COVID period, I did answer, even which I did for the HR success talk, wherein in the offer letter or the appointment letter, until and let's say clause has been put, owing to the unforeseen circumstances or natural calamity or unforeseen activity or whatever it is, unforeseen circumstances or the natural calamity, if the company is not able to provide employment to the person, the company has every right to defer the employment or to postpone the employment until unless such a clause is there, because when it comes to the campus placement or the fresh appointees, the fresh people to join, if you defer it for 3 months, they may accept it. But even for them also, because the other companies, they have foregone their right to join because he had been selected. And if he is not called, you must mention in the appointment. Always you should foresee the possibilities and enforce in the appointment. Unless there is a specific clause in the appointment letter, the company got every right to defer the appointment letter or to postpone the date of joining due to unforeseen circumstances. Otherwise, you got to mobilize the date what is given. And if not, there is a possibility that the employee has a right to sue the employer. If he sues or not is a different thing.
Got it, sir. I think one question which I'm seeing many people asking different ways, so let me articulate it for you. And it is regarding bonds. And many people are asking if bonds are legal in India, if bond is okay, if there is a training given, things like that.
That's good, and we have the second session about the same thing. Our second session is for the bonds, and session two is legal aspects of as far as the bonds is concerned, bonds also again another subject. I don't know, bonds are binding, but it should be reasonable and it should appear like a mutual and reciprocal, the terms and conditions the moment they read it. And it should not be simply say that one side and unilateral, it should not be. Another thing is that in the agreements and the bonds, there should be, again, the agreement and bond need to be specific, it should not be unambiguous. And what are the essential terms and conditions of the bond is that the description of the party should be clearly be there, and the objective of the bond should be clearly be there. There should be an offer and acceptance. An offer and acceptance constitutes a contract, and there should be a consideration. Without consideration, a contract is null and void. Consideration is the same that the payment and other things, salaries and other things, and the employee should give consent. And after giving the consent, there will be also voidable contract, void contract, and there are contracts with contingent contract in the event it happens. Contingent contract is there. Another thing is in the bonds and agreement, we have to ensure that the company who represents an employee who represents the company should be competent to represent the company. Competent to represent the company. That means you should have a proper authorization or a GPA, authorization from the board of the company or GPA from the board of the company to execute contracts on behalf of the company, to sign contracts on behalf of the company. That has to be said. And also, you also have to ensure that the employee who signs the contract has to sign in your presence. But nowadays, what is happening is that these contracts are sent through and the digital signatures are obtained. And you'll have to see that the digital signature belongs to such candidate or some other candidate. You got to ensure it. Otherwise, if it is signed by somebody else in the name of the employee, that demonstrative perjury, employee disowned that. That also precaution has to be taken. Another thing is, in most of the contracts, what I could find is the employer simply takes the signature of the employer and the bonds, printed copies of the bonds, and keep it, he doesn't sign. Because 100 people, 50 people would be joining, they will be putting in the personal file. And certainly the HR person who is competent to sign during the relevant time on the bonds, or CEO, he leaves the employment. And certainly the employee violates the bond. The person who got to sign was not available with the company. And that without the signature of the employer, the bond is invalid. I found many such bonds when they brought to me for filing cases for liquidated damages. Only employee is signed, employer is not signed. Employer who was the person triggered to take signature at the back gate. That person may not be available, and even that is not a good practice. It has to be completely signed there and then at the same time, has to be done. Another thing is that suppose in the event of reporting the training, if the employee doesn't fulfill this minimum service condition and doesn't put in, yes, employer can claim damages. But the damages should be reasonable damages. Reasonable means how the damages has to be computed. What is the cost incurred by the company for selection of that employee? Selection of that employee means going to the campus, staying over there and all these things. So when you have recruited 10 people in that campus, what is the cost involved in the 10 people and divided by, you have selected one, divided by one, how much cost that comes to this particular individual in respect of his appointment costs. And subsequently, the equipment, rentals over the equipment that is provided to him, the computer, PCR, whatever it is, that the man hour spent by the superiors and other things, it has to be worked out. Damages definitely can be claimed, and you must have a proper account for claiming the damages. It can be. Another thing is that in claiming the damages, as I say you, mostly the employees give their answer. Yes, it is almost 12:29 now, Mr. Govind. Shall we continue this to be the second session? We got some more topics to be covered under that.
I think if you can just close it briefly, and then we can take it up in the next session.
I will close it. Then also you have to mention an arbitration clause, and the damages definitely can be claimed by the employee. And again, is the service of summons, service of notices, suit damages. There is various procedure involved in the court adjudication process. That is a different thing. We will discuss it in that stage. Certainly, the damages can be claimed.
All right. Great. Thank you very much. We are already up the time here. So I think we should respect time for everybody. This was really an intense session. So thank you, sir, for your time and answering all of our questions. And I know that there are three more webinars coming and we have a lot to cover. There are a couple of logistic which I would like to put it in place for everybody so that all the audience here is aware of it. One is that we're going to publish the recording of this webinar on the WhatsApp channel. We already have a WhatsApp group where everybody is part of. If you are not part of the WhatsApp group, which we have created for this webinar series, please check your email. You will already have a link to be added there. Second, there are so many questions I have seen which are connected with COVID. And last time we covered all those questions in our webinar. So what I will also do is we will also put the link of the last YouTube interview video with you, sir, so that everybody can get the answers of their questions. Like there are questions like salary cut during COVID or hiring during COVID. And I think all those questions have already been answered there. So we will be working on that. Second, I think we have attendance from many of you. So we will track that attendance. From next time onwards, we will use Google Form to take the attendance to